A sense of place. What I'd like you to do this evening, this afternoon, is try to think about doing archaeology in one of the world's most difficult, contentious regions in the world, and then layer on top of that, doing that work in a highly religious environment. And the question will be, how can we go forward? And what I'm going to suggest is that through a new discipline that we can call cyber-archeology, we have a way to move forward. And a lot of what I'm going to share with you today is a result of research that my students, colleagues, and I have been doing at an amazing new research center at UC San Diego called the California Institute for Telecommunications and Information Technology. It's a mouthful, we'll just call it CalIT. And this is our talk today. When we talk about a sense of place, there are holy places, sacred places for every culture. And here in Northern California, we can think of Mount Shasta. It means certain things for Native Americans. It means certain things for other members of the population. But when we talk about a region, on the regional scale of a holy land, what comes to mind? India, for example, the whole subcontinent, or in the area that I've been working for over 40 years, the Middle East, and in particular, the Holy Land of Israel, Jordan, Palestine. It even extends down to Northwest Arabia here. This is the land bridge between two continents of Africa and Asia. When we think of Jerusalem, this is emblematic of this problem because people of different faiths, people of different social backgrounds, look at a landscape and they see it entirely differently. And we have to remember this. When we look at Jerusalem, for example, the three great monotheistic faiths, Christianity looks at it with their eyes. Here we see the Church of the Holy Sepulchre where Jesus died. This marks that area. The Temple Mount, where Muhammad ascended to heaven. And then if we look on the edge of the Temple Mount, the Western Wall, where Jewish tradition has the temple, the sacred temple. So this landscape is highly charged, and people from different faith backgrounds are going to have different ways of looking at the landscape. And I believe that cyber-archaeology, which is actually the melding of the latest advances in computer science, engineering, and the hard sciences with archaeology, offers a way forward. And one way to think of that is from a personal perspective. I've been grappling with this problem of how to tell an objective story since I was 17 years old and went on my first dig in Israel. You can see me here at the biblical site of Tel Gezer. Yes, we wore pants that short back in those days. And I've tried to work through this, and through our interdisciplinary work in recent years, the last 5 years, I think we've come on to a solution. And that is indeed cyber-archaeology. I started my doctoral research working in the Holy Land, focusing on the role of technology on social evolution, specifically ancient metalworking. And it begins around 6,000 years ago with the first metal revolution in the Copper Age. And I spent my whole early career working on the role of metal, who controlled it, how was it traded, and what was its exact role in society? These are questions that we as anthropologists can look at throughout all the phases of human history, from the Copper Age all the way to Islamic times. And this research led me to focus on some rather large excavations in Israel's Negev Desert, a Copper Age site called Shikmim here. We discovered that all the metals that we found at this site and the copper ore, which you can see here, I'm holding a piece of it with my colleague, Dr. Andreas Hauptmann, It came from over 100 miles away in the deserts of southern Jordan. And this is the area where the copper ore beds are. It's called Fainan. It's about 50 kilometers south of the Dead Sea. That's about 35 miles. We're looking at about 150 square mile area here, very rich in malachite deposits. It's a very rugged terrain. This is about 16 miles as the crow flies here. It's down in the lowlands of this region called Biblical Edom that we have this site called Khirbet al-Nahas, the ruins of copper in Arabic, which I'm going to talk a little bit about today. We're about 16 kilometers from the famous site of Petra that you might be familiar with from one of the movies from from the Raiders of the Lost Ark series. So this is a very important area, and you have to ask yourself, well, how do you get started working in an area like Jordan? And what I came up with was the best way was to create an international expedition where we brought together Israeli, Jordanian, American, that was me, and German scholars, where we reconstructed one of the ancient trade routes from the Fainan area to Israel. It was about a two-week trip on donkeys, and this was a bonding experience. So that was several years after the peace treaty between Israel and Jordan back in 1994. And what we discovered is that we could study the role of mining and metallurgy through deep time, through all those periods of social evolution. And here you can see I'm working in one of these mines with Dr. Mohammed Najjar, my Jordanian colleague. And over the years, we developed very close ties, and we've been investigating these problems of the role of technology on social evolution. And that brought us through all the periods up to the Iron Age. The Iron Age is the biblical period from about 1200 to 500 BC. And it's actually one of the most contentious periods in the archaeology of the Middle East because it has to do with the Bible, the Old Testament. And here you can see one of the most famous Iron Age sites, Khirbet al-Nahas, that we've been excavating since 2002. This is a huge fortress, one of the largest desert fortresses of the Holy Land. It's about 300 feet by 300 feet. There's the gatehouse of the fortress. These are black slag mounds, industrial slag from the smelting of copper ore. And we started to excavate there, and we applied a number of cyber-archaeology methods to test certain historical and anthropological questions. The traditional view is that this Iron Age period, the 10th century BC in particular, this is the time of King David and King Solomon, when, if you read the Bible verbatim, then this was a magnificent kingdom at this time, the Israelite United Monarchy. And here you can see a painting by Edward Poynter showing the beautiful Queen of Sheba meeting with Solomon in his palace in Jerusalem. The other view is what we call the biblical minimalist view, which says since the Bible was created, it was edited in its final edition around 500 BC, that anything earlier, like about the 10th century BC, would be total fiction. And if that was true, then characters like David and Solomon were no stronger than petty mafia dons, if you like. And this is really, in a nutshell, what the scholarly debate is. So how can we approach this in an objective fashion? And we do this through the harnessing cyber-archaeology for data collection, data management, analysis, and scientific visualization. This is a model of Khirbet al-Nahas, that's a photo, with all the different tools that we've developed. This is a scientific visualization 3D display we have in our lab. These are scanners for scanning artifacts in 3D, high-definition digital photography, a balloon system for aerial photography, a LIDAR system for scanning sites, GPS units for collecting individual data points, so you have the exact X, Y, and Z elevation values, and then other elements that we use in the area. Now, what this does is it creates what we could call a data avalanche, and here you can see our last three excavation seasons, 2007, 2009, and last fall, we just got back from our excavations, and we're measuring the amount of data in gigabytes. So if you figure one, you could put one Bible on 4.5 megabytes, you could put 220 Bibles on 1 gigabyte. And so that just gives you an idea of this exponential growth in data. So cyberarchaeology pulls it all together and enables us to tell the story of what happened in the past. So one of the tools we use is called LIDAR, which is light detection and ranging laser scanning of archaeological sites. So instead of collecting one data point, X, Y, and Z, which is accurate to plus or minus a centimeter, we can now collect 1.5 billion data points in several days of work. And here you can see we're taking that point cloud data and we're able to go to that fortress that we looked at. And our work also utilizes radiocarbon dating. We've produced the most radiocarbon dates, over 100 for any archaeological site from the Iron Age. And we can throw in, using the LIDAR as a kind of scaffold, we can put geographic information system data, that is the layers and every single artifact that we find, these are the actual radiocarbon dates in their layers, and we can see when this thing was constructed. And the fortress was constructed exactly in the 10th century BC, the time of David and Solomon, and this shows us that the instruments of state power were in place at this time in the southern Levant. And this goes against the biblical minimalist perspective. We've also excavated through those deep slag mounds on the site, okay, those black slag mounds. And what we see when we do the radiocarbon dating is that we have basically two main phases of copper production here, in the 9th century BC and the 10th century BC. That means that down here, there's over 12 feet of industrial scale slag. That means that only a state level or a kingdom level of social integration could have actually produced and organized metal production at that time. So this is an amazing discovery. Did we find Solomon's mines? Did we find evidence of David and Solomon? No, but what we've done is we've put on the table that this is possible, that they were around. And this little clip will give you a feel for how we apply the cyber-archaeology in the field. My undergrads from aerospace and engineering designed this helium balloon platform for stereo digital photography that we can fly on a daily basis over the site. So here's Chirbat Nahas. This may be a ritual center over here. There's the big fortress that we looked at, the gatehouse. This is a central area, an administrative building, a tower, another area over on this site, all contemporary in the 10th century BC. You put that together and you can create an amazing reconstruction of what this site looked like from a social and an anthropological perspective. These are the markers of a state-level society. And we can go further. We can take our individual data and collaborate with other members of the Middle East community. Our university has a working relationship with King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, a brand new university. We have built them a scientific visualization lab, which is about 3 times bigger than what we have at UCSD. Guess why? Here you can see, I was lucky enough to be invited to the opening of KAUST in 2009. And here I'm showing my friend Sami Almaguth, the data from that deep section through the slag mound at Khirbet al-Nahas. And we've plotted every single artifact in its absolute location at the site. And so we can see patterning in the data, we can reconstruct the technology, and so on. And everybody is interested in telling their story. Every culture has a story to tell, and cyber-archaeology is that place where we can all come together and show that. And finally, in closing, I'd like to say some remarks about how we can share these data, not only with the scholarly community, but also with the public at large, with you. And so with a friend of mine, Steve Savage from Arizona State University, we've built a cyber infrastructure over the web where we call it the Digital Archaeology Atlas of the Holy Land, where we can load in thousands of data, just everything from site location to individual artifacts. So if I take a potsherd like this, this is really a piece of trash, right? But for us archaeologists, if we can contextualize it, then it becomes, it's like gold. It's gold in terms of its historical value. And so we deliver all our data over a Google Earth platform. So now we're back to Israel, Jordan, the south end of the Dead Sea. We're flying down over Google Earth to Khirbet al-Nahas. There's the fortress. There's this pot. And we can burrow down and see exactly where it's from. And it begins to have a lot of social and contextual meaning that we're able to do through cyber archaeology. So finally, the last thing I'd like to say is just that we work with the Department of Antiquities of Jordan. We take their LIDAR data like this from Petra, this is the treasury, and we can model it in 3D. This becomes a nice conservation tool, but we're taking it one step further by using LIDAR as a research platform, which I tried to show you. So finally, good news, about 18 months ago, Popular Science voted our lab one of the 30 top awesome college labs. So we're very proud of that. Thank you very much.